And again, I say, rejoice. Praise the Lord. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say what?
Rejoice.
Now, what is to rejoice? To be happy. Hallelujah. Yeah. Sometimes it's not possible for you to be happy by yourself. Sometimes things are not working the way you want them to work. But when you are in the Lord, it's possible for you to rejoice in the Lord. Hallelujah. In another scripture, the Bible says, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. Remember, joy is not the same as happiness. Happiness is a feeling. It comes and goes. Sometimes you just see yourself dancing because things are working. You are passing. You have money in your pocket. Somebody said some nice things about you. You are happy. And all of a sudden, somebody sends you a very wonderful message on WhatsApp. Already, the happiness is gone. You are now sad. You just switched off from happiness to sadness. But the joy of the Lord is a fruit of the Spirit that actually stays with you. Such that even when you are going through trying times, when you are going through times that people think you should be fragmented by now, you should collapse by now, they will be surprised. Your enemies will look at you and wonder, does it mean she didn't hear what we said? Does it mean he can't feel what we are doing on him? Praise the name of Jesus. The joy of the Lord. Look at this. The man writing to the church at Philippi is called Paul the Apostle. And according to history, Paul wrote this letter to the Philippians while he was in prison. Right. What had he done for preaching the gospel? Hello? Some of us, we can't actually rejoice. We are even angry with God because of what we did wrong. Hello? Haven't you seen that happening? People have wronged God. They have wronged other people and they are angry. Paul did not wrong anyone. Paul was preaching the gospel and the expectation was God was to protect him. That's what the Bible says. But Paul had the joy of the Lord in him, such that while he is in prison, he is even encouraging those that are out of prison. Have you ever imagined it? How many of us have been to prison before? Even to preach, not to stay there. Yeah, you have gone to preach at the prison. How did you feel? Do you feel excited when you go to preach at the prison? It's devastating. It's devastating. You speak to some of those people and you see some of them actually, they didn't do anything. They are accused and they don't have lawyers to represent them. Hello? Some of them were thrown in there by the devil. It's demonic. It can't be explained. They might even have a lawyer. They hire a lawyer. They have the money. They hire the lawyer. When their case is to be heard, the judge is sick. It's postponed. The judge has a funeral. He can't come. She can't come. Or maybe his lawyer or her lawyer actually connives with the other side. He's given money. Tell your neighbor, that's not my portion. So there are people in prison who are at fault. There are others who are not at fault. But whatever the case might be, we learn from Paul. No matter how hard things can be, whether you are at fault or you are not at fault, you can still decide to keep your joy. He writes to the church at Philippi. He says, rejoice in the Lord. I repeat, rejoice. Who is writing someone in prison? For doing what? For preaching the gospel. How many of us here? Oh, now, let's not imagine you in prison. Because some people have imprisoned themselves by themselves. They are walking, they are free. They are not in prison, but they are in prison of the mind. May the Lord grant us grace. Now, this can happen to people among us here. It's also happening to people outside, whom we are supposed to tell, rejoice. Come to our Jesus so that you can rejoice in him. You cannot rejoice without him. It's a fruit of the Spirit. So for us, if we want to rejoice always, 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 regardless of what has happened, you want to rejoice? It's a fruit of the Spirit. You get it when you are walking with Christ. Regularly talking to Him in love with Christ. Hallelujah. Now, the same thing applies to the people outside. People are doing strange things. People are bound by the powers of darkness. People are bound by terrible habits, and they are waiting for you and me to bring them to Jesus so that they will know the goodness of the Lord, so that they can also have the joy of the Lord, so that one day they can also stand here and say, the joy of the Lord is my strength. Hallelujah. Was it yesterday or the other day? I got an email from Texas, USA. There's a lady I've been ministering to online. And this lady was being harassed by the husband. Beatings, emotional, what? And at one time, I didn't know how to say it, but I just thought, okay, I'm praying with her, but I think for her, if she's going to survive, I think she should just leave the husband. But from experience, I now know you don't advise those things because it turns against you. So I was just saying it in a different way to try and show her that can't she at least, you know, be away from him for a moment. Guess what? We kept praying, kept sending the word to her. She sent me an email. She said, Apostle, you don't know what your prayers have done for me. My husband is now listening to the word for hours. Hello? An abuser, the joy of the Lord has visited that family and the situation has been turned around. How much joy do we get from that? Wouldn't it be exciting if you have people from anywhere, all over the world, or even here in BAC, you meet this one and say, thank you, sister, because of your prayers. Thank you, brother, because of that sermon you gave me. Thank you, sister, because of that book you gave me. My life has changed. Oh, I had a problem. I had a heart problem. They said I had a hole in my heart, but you prayed with me. I went to the doctors. They tested me. They said that hole has disappeared. How much joy do you derive from that? People are going through serious problems. So she was telling me, for the past 1 month, no emotional abuse, no beating, no nothing. Actually, the other day, I had a migraine. I had feeling terrible headache. And I told my husband, and he came and he laid hands on me and he prayed for me. Wow. The abuser is now abusing the devil. I see that happening in your life in the mighty name of Jesus. From today going forward, I see you making impact all over Botswana, all over Africa, all over the world in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Listen to this. There's somewhere where I'm going with this message. For you to be able to have joy in the midst of problems, it's because you have big picture thinking. It's not about you. It's about others. Some of us here are very good singers. Hello? But you saw the person who was leading us in prayers saying, anybody to sing? Singers are there. They are preserving their voices to sing for their friends tomorrow at lunch hour or something. I don't know. I don't know where they use their voice for. Praise the Lord. Are you using your talents enough? Are you using your talents enough? Do you know there's a message I sent, an audio, which looks like a video, which I sent this morning, which is entitled, I Do This or I Die. Do you know, I left work yesterday and I had a terrible headache. I got home, I rested a bit. I woke up after an hour or so, I felt like the headache was there or it was not there, I was not sure. Immediately I'm thinking, so what is the next thing I must do to touch generations? Because as long as I am still breathing, Satan, shut up! Nonsense. As long as I'm still living, even headache must go. I have work. So I arise from there, I take my phone, I go into another room, I begin to record. Speaking to the nurses, that's what we were born to do. Headache or no headache. My daughter saw me coming from that room after recording, says, you are already okay. I say, okay or no okay. I'm okay. Praise the name of Jesus. Don't look pitiful. Paul was in prison. I'm not even in prison. Are you in prison? Why are you imprisoning yourself? When are you going to use your talents for God? So people will hear that message and say, They think it was released by somebody who was 100% solid. I wasn't. I was feeling pain on the head. That same head is what I'm using. Now, I declare! Because as long as I am breathing, Satan is in trouble. Rejoice in the Lord. I repeat, rejoice. At one time, Paul mentions, he says there are some people who are preaching the gospel and putting pain on me because of my chains. There are others who are preaching the gospel from a good heart. But there are those who are preaching the gospel not with a good heart. But what pleases me is this: the gospel is being preached. Do you hear that? Paul was a dangerous man. So you get to a level where it's not about you. It's not personal. It's bigger than you. That is what motivates you to arise and be singing and be praying and be preaching, even when you are not well, even when you don't have money. There was a time I used to go to the prisons to preach like my sister. Huh? I had my skorokoroka. And you know when you have your skorokoro and things are not yet balancing. Sometimes it has fuel, sometimes it doesn't have. Sometimes it just decides to keep quiet at the robots. And all those things. So sometimes I will just be running. The time to go and preach at the prison is ready. And this guy is refusing. It's okay. It's the skorokoro that has died. At least I'm alive. Boom! It's not skorokoro that preaches. It's me who preaches. I'll tell my wife, honey, I'm going to preach. My husband. You know, because she was trying to understand. She was feeling pity for me. Are you with me? Even when you have nothing, you will still serve. Another time we went to a certain place with my wife and we wanted to donate to the orphans. Do you know we failed to donate two places? We got there, we tried to say we want to come and do motivational speaking to the children and then also to bring whatever we have. In both places, they looked from the shoe. You look at the trouser. You know, some people know how to size others. I wish they would try to do it now. Because God is not, what do you call it? God is not a what? A respecter of persons. You may not have certain things today, but when you truly love God and you see the big picture for others and for the kingdom, God will lift you. He's a faithful God. So somebody will look from shoe. Is this shoe for someone who can donate? This guy looks like he needs donations himself. They look at that. I mean, I don't know. Guys, have you seen people who can look at you? I mean, you are seeing them and they can see you are seeing, but they will size you. That is to say, you have no hope. And I have no regret for sizing you because you have no hope. So they will look, they go like this, they go like this, they go to your head, they say, sorry, we are fine here. We are fine here. That's a human being for you. But rejoice in the Lord. I repeat, rejoice. You have the joy of the Lord. There are people out there that need the same joy. You have the peace of God because of Jesus, the Prince of Peace, who lives in you. People don't have peace. I normally tell my family, we shared, some of you, if you are here, you are sharing a house. Like if you are in a room and the other rooms are used by others, you know what I'm talking about. I shared houses and rooms in different places. That's when I saw that the devil is very wicked. I remember one man who will beat his wife every night. One day I thought, I think this guy is taking everybody here for granted. And this thing must stop. I'm a man of God, but I think I must open that door and deal with him. If he kills, let him kill me. Why do you beat your wife every day? Every day. I remember we were sharing elsewhere. And this woman, she's crying. She's being hit on the wall. You know those walls for some of these, the ways they demarcate. Oh, you are killing me. The knife is getting into my mouth. Oh, I'm bleeding. I'm thinking, what do I do? Should I call the police? What's wrong with these people? But during the day, they look very good. At night, things are happening. People need Jesus. And that Jesus is where? Is in your heart and in my heart. What are we doing about it? Do you know, even here in BAC, there are students that don't know what else to do because of substance abuse. And here we are, we go to our churches, we carry our Bibles and feel very sanctimonious, feel very special. Oh my gosh, if Jesus comes and just go to heaven, what are you going to heaven to do? What have you done? You are going to heaven to do what? Okay, by chance, let's say you go there. But when people are getting crowns, which crown are you getting? You think God is a joker? Which award are you going to get for doing what? For appearing all the time in CU? For being nice and reading your Bible, you get awards? Never! That's why they joke like this. They say one time people were getting into heaven and Saint Peter was there. He was the one who was giving the trophies and everything. And then as they were getting, one big pastor arrives on the day. And he was lucky. He was allowed to enter heaven. For some reason, he was a good guy, according to God. So, in front of him was a taxi driver. And he knew the taxi driver. So he saw the taxi driver getting a golden crown. He said, if taxi driver can get golden crown, what about big pastor? I was running a big congregation. And then when his turn came, they gave him something wooden. He said, no, excuse me, St. Peter, this is wrong. I think you were supposed to give this wooden something to that man who has gone in. The gold is mine, I was a pastor. And the joke goes on to say, St. Peter said, no, you, when you were preaching in church, people were sleeping. But the taxi driver, each time he was driving, he drove so fast that everybody was praying. At least he caused people to pray. But you caused people to sleep. Praise the name of Jesus. Help me ask your neighbor, what are you doing for God? What are you doing for Botswana Accountancy College? What are you doing for your family? What are you doing for Botswana? What are you doing for Africa? When you wake up in the morning, what comes to your mind? It's about you. My weave. My dress. My suit. Is my tie okay? We are tired of it. Wake up and think, what can I do for my generation? Are you with me? Look at Joseph. They threw him in the dungeon. They wanted him dead. And then he became a slave in Egypt. If you were Joseph, what would you have done? Would you want to see your father's children again? You are joking. See who? You wanted me dead? Now I'm prime minister and you are still looking for food. We shall see. I will give my father food, but all of you shall learn. But what does Joseph say? He says, you meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. Fear not. He took good care of his brothers. Why? He was a leader. He was a man with a big heart. He didn't do it for himself. He did it for others. David is a man with a very interesting story. You read the Bible, 2 Samuel from chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, chapter 4, chapter 5. Very interesting chapters. You see David. You know David was the one who killed Goliath, right? After he killed Goliath, there was a song that was composed. Saul killed thousands, but David killed tens of thousands. It never got to David's head. It didn't. David knew that Saul, no matter how bad he becomes, he's the Lord's anointed. David is picked from taking care of sheep, and he comes to serve Saul. Interesting, the Bible says, the evil spirit from God. You know, if you have an evil spirit from the devil, it might be understandable. But when you have one from God himself, the one which God has permitted to deal with you, you are in serious trouble. And then somebody gave advice. They said, no, let's look for an anointed person who can play an instrument under the power of God so that this evil spirit tormenting our king will go away. And they found an anointed young man called David. David was the one who was supposed to take over from Saul. Praise the Lord. But we see David playing the instrument and the evil spirit from God would disappear. That same Saul will look for a weapon to kill David. People are wicked.
Wicked people rarely change. You know that? I'm singing, I'm playing instruments so that you are free. And you want to kill me on top of it. But David did not hold it against him. He didn't take it personal. Because he had a greatness in him. He was a great leader. To an extent where the Bible tells us, the day when Jonathan and Saul died in battle, the young man who came running to tell David the good news, to say, "Master, the person who has been looking for your life, I have come to tell you he's dead, and I'm actually the one who finished him off." This boy thought it's time for promotion, I think. He thought it's time to be honored by the king, I think. He thought he had done a good thing. You know what he was asking? He was asking, "Where are you from? Why did you not fear to touch the anointed of the Lord?" David, wait a minute. Anointed with which one now? Saul was anointed before he got demon. So is he still an anointed one of God? According to David, he was still anointed. Is that what we do, children of God? Today, the body of Christ is divided. Divided. If we are not careful, the church, if it was not for God's grace, the church was going to end. Like, finish. And Islam will be going up. One day I will bring you the statistics so that you get angry and you really get serious with winning souls. We need to get serious with God's work. If your heart is not beating for God, it is beating for the devil without knowing. Praise the Lord. You need to have a big heart. So David commanded that this man who said he finished off Saul, remember, he did not just finish off Saul. Saul asked it. That I'm in pain, I've been wounded. Can you just finish me off? The young man just did what he was asked by the king, but he died for it. David did not tolerate anybody who did not think big. Why did you kill the anointed of the Lord? Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I don't know. What is stopping you from serving God to the fullest? Is it problems? Is it lack of money? Is it your studies? What is it? But for you, I know you are here because you love the Lord. Amen? I'm just challenging us to say, let's go and do more. We spend time on WhatsApp. How many people have you brought to Christ through WhatsApp? You are checking people's statuses every day, checking statuses, and you are waiting for Jesus to come. Jesus to come for you. You who work at WhatsApp. May the Lord grant us grace. Let's rise to our feet. Hallelujah.